the capital. But the question is, what will this really mean? What is the message that's been sent out? Are we now going to really see a new Team Modi? Are we going to see the major challenges of the pandemic being met by a new team of ministers? Or is this a Modi-centric, PMO-driven government? Also, what are the new ministers going to do with their portfolios? Now, one of the more urbane faces of this new shake-up is Rajiv Chandrasekhar, who has just become the Union Minister of State for IT and Skill Development. Here he lists out his priorities and also the challenges before this government in an exclusive interview. Take a look. Joining us now is one of the new urbane faces of the Narendra Modi Council of Ministers, Minister of State for Skill Development, Electronics and Information Technology, Rajiv Chandrasekhar. Congratulations, Rajiv.
Thank you, Rajiv.
On becoming a minister. What's the big message that you think that the Modi government has sent by bringing in 43 new and old entrants, including some being elevated to cabinet, people like you being brought in for the first time? What do you think is the message of this major cabinet expansion?
For people like me, it is a singular honor and a privilege to be given an opportunity to serve. I have served for 15 years as an MP. And for the Prime Minister to reach out and give people like us an opportunity to serve in government is, in my opinion, a singular honor. It is an opportunity to contribute to his vision of building a new India and to an Atmanirbhar Bharat. So that is what I personally get out of this.
No, that's what you get. Yeah. What, you know, the headlines in the media today have been either big bang cabinet, reset of government, and then there are cynics who say the more things change, the more they remain the same. This is a very PMO-centric, PMO-controlled government. At the end, all of you ministers will be showpieces. There is one supreme leader. So there are two views.
No, look, I think I'm aware that it is it's normal practice to be baited into a controversy, but I don't necessarily see any of that backstory that you see. I think it is clear to everybody who is an observer of Indian democracy that we are emerging from one of the most difficult periods in our independent history, which is the COVID and the devastating effects of the global pandemic, and that we have to, if we have to build back our economy, build back the momentum that was in place before the COVID hit us, there is a lot of hard work that needs to be done. And I think if there is a message that I get out of it, and of course you are all better experts at interpreting tea leaves than I am, but I think the message is that we have a lot of hard work to do to get back into addressing the other issues apart from healthcare, the economy, jobs, all of those important issues that are very, very much becoming back on the center of the radar, which we all of us were preoccupied with the healthcare emergency that the COVID represented. So that is what I take out of it. I think that he's got more soldiers to fight the battles that have to be fought in expanding the economy, getting opportunity and prosperity to a billion Indians.
No, I think you make a point that many are also seeing in this cabinet reshuffle, which is the fact that the economy in post-pandemic times, and indeed society, has to be dealt very differently. I mean, the health sector, the education sector, and critically the economy itself.
Yes.
For example, you are now MOS in skill development, and there's a belief that you need to create far more jobs. I mean, if you look at unemployment levels, and I know government ministers will dispute the numbers, but the fact is that unemployment is hurting, and people have lost jobs, lost incomes in the last 12 to 18 months during the pandemic. So is that, in a sense, the message, as you said, that many of you now have to focus on these areas, and an admission at one level that you haven't done enough?
Look, I think, Rajdeep, if you are sort of dispassionate and clinical observer of the implications and the repercussions of the COVID pandemic, globally, this COVID pandemic has cost both lives and livelihoods. And so there is no doubt from it, there's no running away from that. But what I think the Prime Minister intends to do, and what we are all here to do as part of his team, is to work very hard to take India back into the same growth trajectory and momentum that we had predicted before the COVID pandemic. If you remember, we were all talking about a $5 trillion economy as a goal. And that $5 trillion economy, given the last 18 months of the hit that we have taken, the global economy has taken, needs to be built back. That momentum needs to be built back. And I think, and this is where I believe, at least from my personal perspective, that the vision of skilling India that the Prime Minister laid out in 2015, the vision of digital India that the Prime Minister laid out in 2015, are even more relevant today in the post-COVID world, not just for India, for the world.
So you're saying two things. One, you're saying that the $5 trillion economy dream still lives on?
100%.
I mean, we surely aren't anywhere close to achieving that, whether in the timelines that the Prime Minister had framed, given the growth rates in the last 18 months.
No, I think, Rajdeep, if you take the cynicism out of the picture and look at this realistically, we were at $2.7 trillion and we were on track to hit a $5 trillion mark in 3 years. Mm-hmm. When we first projected, when the goal of $5 trillion was laid out, but we've had this very significant pandemic hit us. Not just hit the economy of India, by the way, it has hit the global economy, and the global economy has shrunk. It is not only now, on the back of these massive stimulus packages in the US and the Western world, that the global economy is beginning to pick up. We have to now work very hard, both in areas of, from my perspective, both in areas of digital India, in terms of technology, innovation, and also in skilling, in terms of contributing to this mission of a $5 trillion economy.
While the pandemic undoubtedly has hurt the economy, the fact is the economy had started slowing down straight after demonetization. We've had, 3 years of successive decline in our growth rate. So yeah, something has gone wrong. Yeah. So I just wonder whether this is an attempt to refix and reset. Is there an admission that we haven't done as well as we can? Let's get some new energies.
No, a new direction. No, like I said, Rajdeep, I mean, I think there will always be this attempt to force a narrative
these are hard numbers.
I can quote you number, poetry and verse about where our economy was pre-COVID and the impact of COVID and where our economy will be 2 years from now. I can also give that
are you disputing the fact that the economy slowed down even pre-COVID?
No, I don't dispute the fact. I'm saying that there are many multiple reasons for it, and to lay it on the door of one particular act or not is oversimplifying it. And I don't want necessarily to get into that debate today. The reason why you wanted to meet me and we are speaking today is about what I believe are the opportunities today in Digital India and Skill India. And I think the Digital India and Skill India, as the Prime Minister has laid out, are very, very important parts of the post-COVID Indian economy and post-COVID Indian growth story. And therefore, I believe it's a privilege and honor to be serving here.
Let's talk about that a bit, Skill India in particular. You know, this was one of the Prime Minister's ambitious flagship program. Now, we've seen that some ambitious flagship programs like Swachh Bharat have made a genuine difference on the ground. However, Skill India never really has taken off. There's a sense that this is one area where there's been a lot of talk, but much less action.
Skilling as a concept, skilling as a mission is a very, very important aspect of what we can promise our youth. Mm-hmm. It is a gateway of prosperity and opportunity for the youth. Now, for somebody to sit and say that skilling has failed, skill has not worked, look, everybody's entitled to their opinion. I personally feel that the platform for Skilling India has been laid. It's a very solid platform. Yes, there is an argument that in the post-COVID world, the types of skill that the youth require may not be remarkably qualitatively different in some aspects from the skills that we thought were required in 2019. Mm-hmm. Because technology is playing a bigger and bigger role in what skills people, youth need today.
Yes.
Even for a normal small business, having a digital aspect for that business, people are working from home. Technology, media, content are all migrating to digital platforms. So there is an argument that the skills that we thought were important, let's say 5 years ago,
mm-hmm.
may not be the complete set of skills that are required for the next 5 years.
So
that kind of constant dynamic sort of evolution of what we consider are important for the young people of India is a natural, flexible approach of any responsible government. But to say that just because we picked 2-3 other new areas in 2022, mm-hmm. and that represents that what we were doing in 2018 was wrong, that is wrong. This is in a particular context.
My point is that these are very nice buzzwords. Skill India was is needed. No one denies that you need to skill the young to face the challenges of a new economy.
I'll say this to you very simply. When Digital India was launched, I met many people that said, and I can pull out tweets and all of that, that say it is a buzzword. Mm-hmm. And effectively during COVID, one of the biggest things that came to help the Indian economy was the investments and the initiatives that this government launched on Digital India. The backbone, the internet, the increase in penetration, that is what allowed
it's so many... It's a continuum. You know it better than anyone else. As one of the original entrepreneurs, it's been a continuum over 30 years. It's not as if it started in 2014.
No, but I'm saying you characterize Skill India as a buzzword, and I'm saying that people characterize Digital India also as a buzzword. Mm-hmm. So for people who don't understand this multi-year transformational programs, everything will seem like a buzzword, but they look for instant gratification. What this government is trying to do is create multi-year transformation through skilling. Skilling is not something that happens over 6 months. Skilling can't transform 400 million youngsters in 6 months and give them all the skills that are required to compete in the world. So these are programs that are structurally long term, medium term, have to be executed well, and I believe that the government has done well.
You know, what I find interesting is that you've got skill development, IT, electronics, and there is an element of synergy, as you said, yes. And it's also an attempt being made that you've got the education minister now also handling skill development, Dharmendra Pradhan. You've got Ashwini Vaishnav, who's railways, and also handling IT and communication. Yes. There seems to be an attempt to synergize ministries. Am I allowed to say that that's also a buzzword, synergy? Because, you know, there's a belief that we need minimum government, maximum governance. Now, this has been the Prime Minister's own stated claim. Right. But actually, what we've now got is 78 ministers. Do you see in areas like Digital India a need for less government and more governance? More, unleash the private and entrepreneurial energies much more in the next 5 years.
So Rajiv, I think we set out to talk about me taking charge
yes,
of my ministry.
Yes, but these are ministries that you're going to handle.
I think these are questions about, these are questions that everybody is entitled to ask. In my opinion, maximum governance is a concept that the Prime Minister introduced about delivering mm-hmm. maximum benefits to the consumers and citizens of India, mm-hmm. making sure a government works hard for its consumers and citizens of India, reducing the government footprint. And the government has done that. In this particular context, when you are recovering from COVID, it's like an all hands on deck kind of a situation. Understand something, we are not in a normal situation. As much as we would all like to pretend that the worst is behind us, as the government of Singapore recently said, we have to learn to live with the pandemic. We have to learn to live with the fact that this pandemic is a risk that continues. And therefore, if there are more ministers that come in, there is more hard work that is put in by the government. I don't see any of these as being contradictions in the way that you are putting it. Mm-hmm. I see our mission today, as I see it, as a junior minister of state, and I'm a junior minister of state, and I don't want to pretend that I'm anything other than that, is that I see this as being a concerted effort by the Prime Minister of our country to say, let us now get really focused, let us start really building back the building blocks that we require to get our economy to start expanding again. And for that, as far as I am concerned, I have two pieces mm-hmm. of work that I can deliver on, which is the Digital India piece and the Skilling
India.
One
of those pieces is Digital India, and I know you've been very vocal about this,
yes.
which is one of the first challenges that you're going to face, which is how to deal with social media. You've seen what's happened with Twitter. And some believe, there is speculation that Ravi Shankar Prasad, the previous minister, paid a price for this fractious relationship that he had with social media giants. You know, it was making the headlines virtually every day. You've also spoken out as a BJP spokesperson on it. Do you believe that that issue has to be taken to its logical conclusion, that all social media companies or anyone in the digital world also has to conform to Indian laws?
No, look, I think the Union Minister for IT, Mr. Ashwini Vaishnav, and I have just taken charge today. These are all important questions.
But you've already, because in your previous avatar as a BJP spokesperson, and indeed someone who has been talking on this often, you've been very clear that you believe that these social media giants have to conform to Indian laws.
Yeah, I don't think there is a man, woman or child in India that wouldn't agree with the proposition mm-hmm. that anybody doing any work in India should conform to Indian law. What is mm-hmm. so controversial about that? Mm-hmm. That is a simple...
but it's become very fractious and, you know...
So, I was referring to that point of yours.
Yes.
I was saying that to the question of whether it's fractious or not, I think you need to give this new team in Meti an opportunity to study the issues, understand the issues. There is a cabinet minister there, there is a minister of state there, there is a full team of people there. We will study these issues and come back to the public and the media at the appropriate time.
Because there's a belief that, you know, whether it's digital media, whether it is these sort of global giants, all of them need a regulatory framework that is transparent, that is fair.
Absolutely.
And that applies to all.
And this is not a uniquely Indian idea. This is an issue that the world, economies of the world and governments of the world and democracies of the world are having to deal with. There are some countries like China that deal with it by just completely banning them, not allowing them access.
Mm-hmm.
And there are many countries that are having to deal with this. For democracies like India, these platforms do represent a challenge in terms of regulation. And what will be the nature of the regulation, what ought to be the nature of the regulation, what should be their role, what should be the government's role, what should be the institutional capacity built to regulate these entities. These are all issues that
the criticism is that it could lead to misuse of police powers, arbitrariness or authoritarianism, and will be used to clamp down on free speech.
Look, nobody can clamp down on free speech in India. We know it. It's a guaranteed fundamental right.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, just because somebody huffs and puffs about it.
No, it's guaranteed in the Constitution.
Yeah,
but in reality, there have been instances where governments, yours
you
and
remember,
others have clamped
you
down.
You remember during the UPA government, Section 66A, I went to court, I raised it in Parliament, nobody did anything about it, and the Supreme Court struck it down.
Mm-hmm.
There are courts, there are processes of judicial intervention. If anybody feels that the right to free speech is being curbed, it's a guaranteed fundamental right, Rajdeep. This is not some women fancy thing.
You actually were in the business of telecommunication
technology.
And technology in its very early years with BPL Mobile, and therefore have experience on the ground working in the industry, and now you've got a chance to look at it from the other side.
Yes.
Do you believe that's an advantage? A lot of people believe this government is short of talent and expertise, and you need more people who've actually had that ground experience.
I think that is one of the biggest myths, that the government is short of talent. I have friends in the government, I have friends who are members of parliament, who are all very, very bright, very, very well informed people. I think if there are people in Delhi who want to type a certain type of a government minister as being intelligent or non-intelligent, I think this is a very sad characterization, that unless you are urbane and you wear a suit or you wear a, you are slick or something, that you are not intelligent.
No, yesterday it was the government itself which was telling us how many PhDs are now there in the government, how
you
many
use
masters,
the word urbane.
How many doctors.
No, urbane is
urbane
not...
Urbane meaning the... Yes, in your case urbane, English speaking urbane, but then I'm saying the intellectual heft as well as the ability to actually have had either the political experience on the ground or... As in your case,
I am not real life experience. Let me say this very, Rajdeep. I have been in politics for 15 years, public life in 15 years.
Yes.
I think the brightest and the smartest and the wisest people I have met in public life are not people with great degrees necessarily.
I agree.
It could be the wise men have degrees, but it is not the corollary that if you are not having a degree, you're not wise. So I think the government has put a mix of people with experience, who understand people. I assure you, Rajdeep, every day that I go into meet into government or into parliament, even today when I went into taking charge, I will meet people in politics and public life who will teach me things that I never knew about real things, about real people. So I think to characterize that you need only urbane, degreed people to do service to the people of India is being unjust, is being wrong.
You know, one other characteristic of this government, stereotyping of this government, is that this government is very PMO-centric. That you'll have all the ministers like Rajiv Chandrasekhar, but will you really be given any powers? Will anything be delegated to you? The Prime Minister's office monitors, they're the big boss.
Look, in 10 years of UPA, I know we all lamented the lack of accountability. Okay, it was not clear who was accountable when there was corruption, when there was malgovernance, when there was inflation. Nobody knew who was accountable. We have a government where there is a leader today who stands up and takes accountability. He is responsible for the government. That is the Prime Minister. In my opinion, either you decide you want a leader who is taking full accountability and therefore answerable to the people of India, which is my Prime Minister.
He's accountable? If things go wrong, he's accountable, or are the ministers accountable?
No, look. Now, I am saying you characterize the Prime Minister as being
a micromanager, a big boss.
I don't see that. I have had the opportunity to interact with him for over 9 years now. I have never experienced that. He is a person who encourages, and I think the fact that I am sitting here as a Minister of State is living proof of the fact that he encourages people like me, who, by many descriptions, I don't, I'm not.
You're a lateral entrant in a way into politics.
So
right?
I think you should. Yes, I think. So therefore, I think for us to say this and that, I think that's wrong. Or to the specific point about accountability, I say for myself, I would prefer a leader who stands up there and says, I am Prime Minister, rather than having a Prime Minister who says, I don't know what XYZ Advisory Council told me to do, or I don't know which alliance partner was ripping the country off.
My final point, I see that you're dressed in a good veshti.
Yes.
Is this, again, a style statement?
No.
Is this Rajiv Chandrasekhar? Because one of the aspects of government in the past of BJP governments was they didn't have enough representation from south of the Vindhyas. Now there are more and more, even in this government from your home state of Karnataka yesterday, I think five of you became ministers. So clearly there is a conscious attempt to have a greater, wider representation. Is that a style statement in a way to say Rajiv Chandrasekhar making a distinctive statement? Is that how you're going to the Council of Ministers meeting?
Yes, of course. I
went to office like this today?
Yes, I did. I did. And this is not a style statement. This is the dress that the people of my state wear. This is what I am. I represent them in Delhi. And this is no style statement. I think I am one of them. And I will dress and act and behave and speak like one of them.
But you are not a sort of traditional mass politician. And there is one belief that this government, again, is going through the Rajya Sabha route, making the mistakes of the Congress, making all of you ministers from Rajya Sabha, that you need more mass leaders, mass politicians. Is that a justifiable criticism?
No. But so Rajiv, I think you are asking questions of me that I'm not.
No, you're a Rajya Sabha MP.
If you ask me, should I be here? Should I be given an opportunity to serve? I'll say yes. I would love to serve my country. I would love to do good by my people. And if you say that because I'm in the Rajya Sabha, I should be disqualified from doing good for my people, then I can say that's your thought, and I wish that is not true. And mercifully and thankfully, the Prime Minister doesn't think the way you do.
The one final thing, having the Mantri name now next to you, how does it change your life?
It makes me proud. It makes me proud. It makes my parents proud that after many years, I have, in a sense, being given an opportunity to do more. Mm-hmm. I'm a son of an Air Force officer, so serving is a big thing in my family.
You know, I just wondered, why didn't you become an MOS defense, given your interest in defense?
No, I think I like, it's not about, you can serve the nation in many, many ways. And people think that being an MP is not service. I have considered every year, every day that I've spent as a member of parliament as a way of serving my people. So for me, the MOS opportunity that the Prime Minister has graciously given me is an opportunity to do more. And I genuinely believe that that's the way I feel. That's the way my family has responded yesterday. They were very emotional, and I'm deeply grateful and privileged to have this great honor.
Rajiv Chandrasekhar, we wish you best in your new avatar.
Thank you.
As Minister of State, all the very best. Keep wearing the veshti. Looks nice.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Rajiv Chandrasekhar, one of the new faces of the Modi government.